You might have heard it said that Australia has an ageing population, which is the growth in the number and proportion of older people. Australia isn't unique in the sense that many other countries are also facing this trend, but nonetheless, it has some big implications for society, for healthcare, and the economy. So joining me today to discuss this trend and some of the implications is McCrindle's founder and renowned demographer, Mark McCrindle. Mark, welcome back to the podcast.
Thanks, Ash. Always good to be with you.
I know that recently you were the opening speaker for the Australian Government Department of Health's Aged Care Research and Innovation Conference. Additionally, I also see that the Department of Health is now the Department of Health and Aging. So the fact that they've changed this name and the fact they've run such a big conference on aged care tells us a fair bit about the importance of aged care in Australia and the priority that it has been given. Could you tell us a bit, Mark, about some of the information you shared at that event about the demographics around our ageing population?
Yes, well, that's exactly right, Ash. You know, the demographics are quite compelling, and so appropriately, there's a lot more government funding and national focus on the ageing of Australia and ensuring older Australians are well looked after. You know, the midpoint in our population, if we go back 50 years to the 1970s, the midpoint in our population was still in the 20s, the median age. It was late 20s. Today it's late 30s. The midpoint is 38.7 years of age. So that's the median age in Australia. In a decade, it'll be 40.1 to be precise. So it tells you just how our population is aging, how the midpoint is rising, how we've got more Australians aged over 60 than ever before. In fact, if we look at 65 and over, as a proportion of our population, those that have retired or hitting what's traditionally been that retirement age. Currently, it's around 1 in 5 Australians. In a decade, it'll be 1 in 4. So a rise in the number and the proportion of older Australians. In fact, those aged over 85, currently 2.2%, they'll be 3.1% in a decade. So even though we've aged a lot, the aging will continue. And really, this is a story of longevity. People are living longer and active later, and that's a good news story. There are far more older Australians than ever. In fact, just the over 85s, we currently have about 590,000. In a decade, we'll have almost 1 million Australians aged over 85. Massive increases, even faster than our population growth because of the aging growth. And all of that highlights the need to ensure that there are options for older Australians, that the post-working years are thriving years, and that there's the right resourcing and investment to accommodate the pathway that we're all on to a bright aging future.
It's interesting. I know I've worked at McCrindle for a long time and have delivered presentations on this. And I guess like anything, it's when something happens in your own life that it's kind of brings the data to life. Like we know that the qualitative brings the quantitative to life. And I've got a few elderly grandparents who are going through that. And even as a family, we're trying to work out what's the best way to support them as they become more fragile and need more care and assistance. And I guess, you know, when I was younger, I was like, oh yeah, aging population, sure. But there are some big implications, I guess, at a societal level, at an individual level, about how we look after these people. Mark, what do you often talk about? You know, if someone asks you what are the implications of this aging population, what are some of the insights or the trends that you often share with people when they ask that question?
Well, firstly, understanding that aging today is perhaps different to aging in the past in terms of expectations of older Australians. You know, we need to update our mindset of what a retiree looks like, because someone in their mid-60s is not ready for the pension and to sort of get the discounted meal at the local club once a week. They're active, they're working later, they're traveling more, they're not downshifting from that family home into some sort of aged care. They're upscaling the home to maybe a smaller home, but often a more expensive home. They're updating cars. They're doing a lot of active things. They've got grandkids, and they're far more involved in the grandchildren's lives. Many of them are funding some of the school fees or the bills for grandchildren, or indeed their own children. So we really have redefined what it means to live through these years, largely because people are living longer. Again, if we go back 5 decades to the early 1970s, back then, life expectancy at birth was in the early 70s. Today, it's in the mid-80s, and those longevity gains will continue. Now, just think about that for a moment to those listening. That means that in the span of a generation, we've added about 15 years of life expectancy at birth. And of course, by the time someone's in their mid-60s, they have even longer trajectory than that, well beyond two decades. So to live into one's late 80s or 90s is increasingly the norm. And we're not only seeing increased years of life, but increased activity of those years. So what we have is people working later, people studying later in life, people active as consumers later. We're seeing policy responses to this. That is that it's not about housing these record numbers of over 85s in traditional aged care, but a policy of aging in place, ensuring we can bring the aged care to the household, to the individual, let them remain connected in their communities. Definitely they, like all of us in the older years, are going to need a bit more support and caring. But hopefully in the context, in the housing and the community, where we can maintain those connections, and that'll work for us. So we're rightly seeing a lot more funding go into the rise in aging, but funding in a more 21st century appropriate way, and that's going to speak to the needs and respond to the expectations and options of today's older Australians.
And I think when you mentioned earlier, you know, those different types of ways of categorising ages with regards to aged care and population growth and ageing, we often talk about the, like you mentioned, the 85 plus cohort, and then I think the 65 plus. So I guess if we're thinking about, predominantly we're talking about two generations here. You've got the builders who are aged 79 years and over today, and then you've got the baby boomers aged between 60 and 78, who I guess if we're talking about the future of aged care and aging, we might predominantly be talking about the baby boomers and what their future looks like. I know we have given them, kind of paid homage to them in the past on the podcast. They're a much more than the OK Boomer label that they were kind of branded with a few years ago by the younger generations. But what do you think about, or what do you have to say, Mark, about the baby boomers and who they are and the cultural shift they've had, but also the amount of change this generation has seen over their life so far?
Yeah, well, you know, an absolute plethora of change. And, you know, that's why we're seeing this boom ahead in aged care, because the baby boomers are moving to that life stage, as you've said. You know, there are 5 million baby boomers, this cohort born in those 18 years after the end of World War II. They're one in five of the Australian population, and even higher as a proportion of other comparable countries in the OECD, like Japan, and you've got countries like China on an even faster aging curve. So these baby boomers that were born in record numbers, where the birth rate in Australia was 3.5 babies per woman, it was a fertility rate twice what we have today. They're now, as you said, on the cusp of their 80s, and over the decade ahead, even the youngest of them moving into this post-retirement life stage. They're the grandparents of the youngest generation that we know, Generation Alpha. They're the parents of the millennials, or Generation Y. They have lived through record change. They've ushered in a lot of change. Just some simple anecdotes. When they were born in the post-World War years and into the 50s and early 60s, Eisenhower was the president, you know, the World War II general, became president, and then they were shaped in the Nixon era. In Australia, Menzies was the prime minister as they were born, but Whitlam became the prime minister as they were coming of age. And so it was an era of social change, an era of rights for women, and a lot more social transformation, Australia becoming more multicultural, civil rights around the world, an involved generation of young people. They redefined in their youth what it meant to be activist and bring about change. They moved into the parenting years in record numbers and started families and grew the suburbs of our cities here and around the world. But even into their leadership roles, their community roles, they're contributing and building and booming and volunteering and funding a lot of the charities to this day. And they're going to continue that. So they will approach aging in a very different way. In fact, the life stages have changed. It used to be you did your study at the start of life, and then your working life, and then retirement. Not so for them. They're not retiring. They're moving back into study, they're upskilling, they're retraining, they've had a lot more career transitions, and even post-traditional retirement, they're still remaining active in work, maybe unpaid work, maybe volunteering, maybe on boards and community organisations, or maybe their own business or something on the side, maybe contracting, but they're certainly remaining active in the workforce, in paid work, in employment, and in leadership as well. So yeah, total transformation in their lives and in what we've seen, and even in bringing, adopting and transforming technology. They have ushered in the technology that we know today. They were the software engineers, the developers of the technology that we know. Bill Gates is a baby boomer, for example, and so far from being the Luddites or falling behind with technology, they've adapted to more technology than any other generation, and I think we'll continue to use that in a big way into their future.
They are a really incredible generation, and like you mentioned there, Mark, they're also currently, many of them, I'm sure, in that grandparent era with grandchildren and supporting them. And I guess when I think about the grandparent economy, which is one of the trends that we spoke about in our Trends of 2024 research and event and podcast, we were talking about, I guess, the baby boomers and them redefining retirement and the wealth transfer and their kind of the fact that they've been beneficiaries of some economic conditions that maybe younger generations today find a bit more challenging. How do you see this generation in the baby boomers, I guess, with regards to that net worth and the grandparent economy and that transfer of wealth eventually? How do you see that kind of playing out in the years to come?
Well, they are representative of the high watermark of wealth attainment in Australia. Now, this is not true of every baby boomer, but it's true of the generation as a whole. As I said, they're about one-fifth of the population, but they own half of Australia's national private wealth. So their economic footprint is more than twice as large as their demographic footprint. We've never seen a generation own so much from a wealth perspective, an average household perspective. Their net worth is just a little below, on average, $2 million per baby boomer household. And that's well above the average household wealth of a little over $1 million. Now, much of that is bound up in the family home, but they've got superannuation, they've got investments, and many have other assets as well. So that does redefine what the post-working years looks like. They do have options. And while it's been said that they will be the skiers, SKI, they're spending the kids' inheritance is what some have said, as much as they have been spending as they've moved out of their working years, or their full-time working years at least, their accumulation has actually grown. We ran some numbers about a decade ago and found that the baby boomers owned about $5.8 trillion of wealth collectively in Australia, this big cohort. And so they've been spending as their earnings have been dropping as a generation, as their spendings have been increasing. But interestingly, their wealth accumulation is now beyond the $5.8 billion they've been spending. Sorry, correction, $5.8 trillion is the total wealth that they have as a generation. But as much as they've spent it, it's actually increased, and it's $6.2 trillion today. So that gives a sense as to what they have their money in through super or shares or property has been rising faster than they have spent it. And so clearly, even though they're going to live longer and will use that money through the next decades of their life, there will be a fair bit that they will pass on. And we found that they're wanting to pass it on, not just to charities, which we saw in the past, but to directly benefit those that they've got a connection with, and particularly family members. And we found that actually grandchildren is where the grandparents are looking to pass on. We found in our research up to half of that wealth to give the youngest generation, who don't have the same economic pathway, they've fallen a bit behind where the boomers were at the same age, give them a bit of a chance to get a foothold in owning a home. So yeah, definitely that wealth as a generation has given them options, and I think the transfer of that will be fascinating over the decades ahead.
And one of the statistics I remember actually from when we did this research at the beginning of the year about this grandparent economy, we asked this question in a survey about whether the various generations, when they were kind of younger, have lived with their, you know, grandparents rent free or for reduced rent. And it was 20% of Gen Z today. So one in five have lived with their grandparents, not just their parents, but their grandparents for reduced rent or rent free. And we often make that, you know, joke about the granny flat not being for the grannies or the grandparents, but for the younger Gen Z. So yeah, it's interesting and great to see many older, wealthy, I guess, baby boomers. And like you said, Mark, not every person of that generation is in that position, but a lot of them are and have been. And so it does seem like they're willing to give a helping hand and transfer that wealth maybe even earlier by helping out in different ways. So it's interesting to see that. But as we look at the future and I guess this challenge really that sits before us, I know we've done a little bit of work in previous years around kind of the aged care puzzle, we've called it, even around how do we have enough workforce and manpower to accommodate this, you know, exponential growth. Like you mentioned, you know, a million people becoming of age in the next decade that need, you know, different levels of care. So what innovations or solutions do you foresee emerging to address some of these challenges associated with this aging population?
Well, firstly, with that wealth and with their expectations of aged living, many will be self-funded. And indeed, that's a government policy, more of a user-pay system. It just has to be that way with the growth in these numbers. And of course, not only is there a growth in aged care, there's a growth in disability care in Australia, there's a growth in childcare and obviously healthcare, and there's just not the workers amidst this care boom to accommodate all of that growing need. So many in the older years will self-fund. They will age in place, and so through private support, achieve some of that. I think families will be key to that as well. And you know, the key thing in terms of reducing the labour needs is if people can remain healthier longer, can remain independent later, can remain self-caring later, then that massively reduces the burden, the costs, and the labour demands. And I think we're going to need solutions there. I think technology is helping a lot, and we have people that can live in their homes later because they have the ability with alerts, with technology, with check-in apps, with other technology support, even app-based home services such as delivery of meals or shopping or indeed carer support. They can achieve that independence longer, which is important. We're seeing the retrofitting of homes to be more aged friendly. We're seeing new housing design standards ensure that they have the options for people, future owners of the homes or apartments, to remain there as older people. So wider access for bathrooms and lifts or ramps to ensure that that you know, it's capable for and accessible for people. So I think all of that is really helping into the future. It's the visionary forward planning that's going to assist. But yeah, I think the future in plugging some of those labour gaps or shortfalls in what is a sector that's growing in demand for staff is going to be through migration. And that's how the sector has plugged those gaps. That's why Australia has such a high migration rate, most coming in on a skilled visa program. And it's plugging gaps that can't be plugged purely through technology, and the carer roles are amongst some of those. So I think amid some of those areas, we will see some solutions, but clearly the private sector is stepping in, not just the government sector or the charitable and church sector, to meet the needs of older Australians. And so a multi-sectoral approach, multiple funding opportunities, technology with solutions, migration and skill shortages in new ways. And we're even seeing pay bring people in, the flexibility of casual work allow for people to work in the sector and help plug some of those gaps.
Yeah, it's I'm always like, I think like any topic that we talk about on this podcast or as an organization, the human aspect of it, in terms of that's what we do as social researchers, we study human behavior and demographic trends and insights. And it's always really interesting to think about the different aspects of society or ways of living that these kind of big demographic trends kind of the impacts they have. And I know we've talked about it before, and you've mentioned this on the podcast actually, around just how even like aging population is one of those kind of tidal trends. It's not this flash in a pan. It happens all of a sudden. It kind of creeps up on you. And I'm sure all of us remember hearing about aging population back in high school. But yeah, to think about it from a practical level and how it impacts all of us and some of the implications is a really important aspect to consider. So you can definitely see why you were invited to go and give that opening address at that conference. So yeah, fantastic insights as always, Mark. Thanks so much for the chat today and coming on the podcast.
Well, thanks, Ash.
And if you would like to stay up to date with McCrindle's latest insights, you can always subscribe to the podcast. You can follow us on social media or simply head to McCrindle.com. So as always, thank you for listening, and bye for now.